Rafi talked about what are cache keys last night and how you access the cache, indexing the cache, and find out the data is available or not. So today what we'll do is we'll start with something called a cache hierarchy. That's what is used in today's process. So it is motivated by the observation is that ideally I want to hold everything in a fast cache. So I completely want to avoid going to memory. If memory is slow. But as we know, with increasing size, the access time increases that we talked about earlier. So for any structure, if you make it larger, it will take more time to access. Which essentially means a large cache will slow down every access. So whenever we access the cache, it's going to take a longer amount of time. Okay. So trade-off should be very clear here. If I have a very large cache, I have a large number of picks. So I'll never, probably I'll never miss missing the cache if I make it large enough. But every hit will be extremely slow. So if you look at the total time spent, that's essentially the product of number of hits and the time to access the cache, plus or miss how much time it takes to get the data from the memory. That's the total time spent in accessing the data, whatever amount of data you have. Okay, so that's often called the average memory access time. That's number of hits multiplied by time to access cache plus time to serve the misses, right? Or that this also can be decomposed into number of misses times time for miss. So essentially, a large cache nullifies the second term completely. An infinite cache will not have the second term. Well, not exactly true. Initially, when you start executing, you have to bring some data from memory. And once you have all the data in the cache, you will never miss again. Okay. So nonetheless, a large cache tries to maximize this particular term, number of bits. Okay, right? But this is going to be also very large. So it depends on how these are balanced, and a large cache normally is not very good. Okay. So what people do is they put increasingly bigger and slower caches between the processor and the memory. And the rationale here is that, again, the locality principles that we discussed last time is working here. That is, when you access a particular data point, it is speculated that in the near future, you'll access the data point once again. That's a temporal locality. So what you're doing here essentially is that you put a small cache close to the processor, right? You bring a data point, put it in the cache. And the hope is that you'll access it again in future and have a hit, right? But over time, this data will become old and will probably become useless. Okay? And that data will eventually get replaced by some other data. Again, that will block it. So this small cache close to your processor is a very fast cache. Okay. That is giving you most of the hits from the cache. Okay. Except the first time that you touch a data, it will have to drop it. Okay. Then you put a slightly bigger cache after it, which will accommodate some more data. Okay. And it will be slightly slower and smaller and so on. Okay. So overall, this is going to be better than this. Okay. And this is the punchline, that is, keep this most recently used data in the nearest cache, which is the register file. However, what you put in the register file is not really under the control of the hardware or the architecture. This is decided by the compiler, when you compile a program. What data goes into what register and at what time. Okay, right? The next level of the cache is the L1 cache, the level 1 cache. It's the same speed or slightly slower than the register file, but normally much bigger than the register file. Then you have the L2 cache, way bigger than L1 and much slower. Then you have the L3 cache, which is even bigger and even slower. Okay. And today industry is even contemplating an L4 cache, beyond which there will be memory. Okay, so you put, you know, gradually larger and slower caches between the processor and the memory, bridging this particular latency gap gradually. So here's an example, with a couple of examples. So Intel Pentium 4, it's an old processor. So I'm talking about, so Intel Pentium 4 had several incarnations, gradually with increasing frequency. NetBurst was the first architecture that came out. So here is a memory hierarchy of NetBurst. It had 128 registers accessible in two cycles. So in this class, whenever I talk about registers, I really mean physical registers. So we talked about the distinction between physical and logical registers, right? So of course, all Intel processors would have only 8 logical registers. They have the x86 ISA registers. Here I'm talking about the physical registers inside the processor, not visible to the compiler, managed by the hardware. So it has 128 registers accessible in two cycles. However, again, even though this is under the management of hardware, remember that what data goes into what register is still decided by the compiler, because there is a strict mapping from logical to physical register all the time. Okay, all right. Then you have the L1 data cache, which is 8 kilobytes in size, 4-way SATA sensitive, 64 bytes line size, accessible in two cycles for integer loads. You have the L2 cache, which is 256 kilobyte 8-way associative, 128 byte line size, accessible in 7 cycles. So I mean, as you can see, as you go down, the latency increases, size also increases. Intel Itanium 2, so again, Itanium 2 had several incarnations. So this is the Madison processor. It has 128 registers accessible in a cycle, L1 instruction and data caches, 16 kilobyte each, 4-way SATA sensitive, 64-byte line size, accessible in one cycle. Unified L2 cache, 256 kilobyte, 5 cycles. Unified L3 cache, 6 megabyte, 14 cycles. So it's bigger and it's slower. Okay. Couple of things to notice here. That is, you might ask, well, both of these processors have the same number of registers. This one is accessible in a cycle. This takes 2 cycles. Why? The question is, both of these processors have the same number of registers, but here the register file requires 2 cycle access time, here it requires 1 cycle access. Why is that? Any guess? Exactly, right. Cycle times are different. So Intel Pentium 4 has a much faster clock frequency, Itanium 2 has a slower clock frequency. Right? Okay. So the actual time is roughly the same. if you look at the total size of the register file here, how much is it? So Intel Pentium 4, the one that we're talking about here, is a 32-bit machine. So each register is 4 bytes. Right? So how much does it amount to? 512 bytes, right? Accessible in 2 cycles. Whereas your L1 data cache is 16 times larger, see, 8 kilobytes, has the same latency. How is that possible? What do you think? What could be the reason? So at one point in time, we made a statement that in a memory structure, if you have more ports, it slows down. Right? So can you argue along that line? How many? What decides the number of ports in the register file?
So it depends how many instructions you want to be able to issue in the same cycle.
That decides what? Number of?
Number of required read ports.
Read ports. Yeah. Who decides the write ports?
The number of writes you want to be able to perform in the same cycle.
Yeah. What is that? What does it depend on?
Number of issue.
Number of issue instructions, right? Okay. What about the cache? Number of ports in the cache? Who decides that? Number of read and write ports in the cache?
So write is only one bit.
Write is?
One write is only required.
One write is required?
Only one write is required.
Why?
Cache operation, so you upgrade the
cache. Yes, you're right. Yeah. So where do you write to the cache?
When back to memory eventually.
That's a replacement.
Yes.
That is a write to memory. We're talking about write to the cache.
So there is the cache miss.
If there is a cache miss, then
you have to bring the
you have to bring in the new data. At that time you write to the cache. Okay? Where do you read from the cache?
As instructions require data, then you read from the cache.
What do you think? What would be the requirement compared to the register file ports? What would be the requirement in the caches in the, for the read ports?
It will be half of the register file requirement.
Not really half. I mean, it's smaller.
Load instructions.
It's smaller.
Yes.
Yes. Load and store both will read from the cache. Okay. Store will do some extra work. It will first read the data out, do the new modification, and write the data back to the cache.
Okay.
Right. So data cache ports is a subset of the peak issue width of the processor. Okay, because peak issue width will contain all types of instructions. Okay, and only a subset of that will go to the data cache. Alright? Whereas the register file will have to accommodate all other instructions. Potentially all other instructions. So it has a much larger number of ports. For example, in Pentium 4, if we assume that the issue width is 6, let's say, right? Then your register file would require at most 18 ports, right? 12 read, 6 write. Okay. Whereas your data cache will probably require a couple of read ports, assuming that you can only send pair of load store and at most two memory operations. Right? So that is what is impacting the latency here. If the register file had the same number of ports, it would have a much, much smaller latency than the cache. Okay, just because of number of ports, the register file latency has gone up. Alright? Okay, so that's about the hierarchy. Just notice how the latency increases. Usually it jumps a lot, 5 to 14 L3 cache. Of course, the size is also much larger. Today's processors, normally the high-end server-grade processors have much larger L3 caches today. Okay. Although in this course, probably you won't have time how exactly these very large caches are organized. Keep in mind that they are very large. Okay. They occasionally cross, they routinely cross 10 megabytes. Often they are more than 20 megabytes cache on chip. Okay, so we talked a little bit about states of cache line when giving an example. So let's try to open that up a little bit more. So life of a cache line starts off in invalid state. That is, the line is not in the cache, right? And access to that line takes a cache miss and fetches the line from main memory, all right? If it was a read miss, the line is filled in the shared state. We may discuss it later if there is time. For now, just assume that this is equivalent to a valid state, right? So shared state is just a valid state. In case of a store miss, the line is filled in modified state because you know that you're going to modify the line. Instruction cache lines do not normally enter the M state because there is normally no store to the instruction cache. Instructions are read only. You read instructions and execute them. Eviction of a line in M state must write the line back to main memory. This is called a write back cache. Right? Otherwise, the effect of the store would be lost. So there's a second type of cache, which is called the write-through cache, where whenever you do a store, you not only update your cache, you update the main memory also. Okay. In which case, you won't require the M state, because the memory is always up to date. Okay. So you'll only require two states, valid and invalid, that's all, in your cache. Okay. For write-through caches, there are two flavors. One is called write-allocate, and one is called write-no-allocate. So in write-allocate, write-through caches, what you do is, on a store miss, you allocate the block in your cache. Okay. And you do the store in both the places, in the cache and in memory. In write no allocate, you don't even allocate the block in the cache on a store miss. You only send the data to memory and update the data in memory. So most of the time, we'll be dealing with write back caches. We'll touch upon a little bit on write through caches. And in your homework, you'll actually get to compare a write back and write through cache performance also. You'll see why one is better than the other. There is something called an inclusion policy in a cache hierarchy. So how it is defined? So normally the contents of level n cache exclude the register file. is a subset of the contents of level n plus 1 cache. Okay. If this invariance is satisfied for all values of n, then you say that the cache hierarchy is inclusive, it's completely inclusive. Right? So essentially what it's saying is that whatever I have in my L1 cache is guaranteed to be there in the L2 cache, in an inclusive hierarchy. Okay, right? Now in today's processors, usually implement something hybrid. Okay, so it's usually it is part of the hierarchy is inclusive, part of the hierarchy is non-inclusive. Right? So for example, in a three-level hierarchy in Intel's processors, typically L1 and L2 will not be inclusive. Okay, all right? They won't actually satisfy this property. But L3 will be inclusive with respect to L1 and L2 contents. So anything, the union of L1 and L2 is guaranteed to be in L3. Right? So that's what it really means. But if something is in L2, if something is in L1, it's not guaranteed to be in L2, for example. Right? So that this property is not satisfied for L1 and L2. Okay, so, but however, in this discussion, we're going to assume that we're talking about inclusive hierarchy where the contents of L1 are guaranteed to be in L2. Okay. So eviction of a line from L2 must ask L1 caches, both instruction and data, to invalidate that line in present. The reason should be obvious, because if you don't, you're going to lose this property. Because the line is being evicted from L2, it must also be evicted from L1 caches at that time. Right? Otherwise, there will be a line in L1 cache which is not in L2 cache. And that violates inclusion. Is this fair? Any questions? Yes. Is it okay? A store miss fills the L2 cache line in M state, but the store really happens in L1 data cache, right? So we have L1 instruction cache, we have L1 data cache, we have the L2 cache, and we have our main memory. Okay. So this is what we're looking at here. And this is my pipeline here, the processor pipeline, which would access the instructions from the L1 instruction cache and will do read and write to the L1 data cache. Okay, all right. So what I'm saying here is that let's suppose that there is a store instruction which will follow this path, right? Will first go to L1 data cache, then to the L2 cache, then to main memory, if you don't find the data. So here I'm assuming that I miss in all the caches. So a store access first go to L1 data cache, misses here, then moves to L2 cache, misses here, brings the data from memory, it fills the data on its return path in L2 and L1 data cache, right, both, to maintain inclusion. Now the question is, what would be the state of the data, that the data block, in these two caches? So what it says is that the data block in L2 cache will be in M state, okay? Even though the store actually happens in this cache. So when you modify the data, you actually don't notify the new data to L2 cache. L2 cache is still having the old data, okay, all right? So L2 cache does not have the most up-to-date copy of the line. The reason is that it's not needed, okay? So implicitly, I'm actually saying that the L1 data cache is a write-back cache. Only when it is evicted, that particular block, the new data will be written back to the L2 cache. Right. So that's what it really means. All right. So eviction of an L1 line in M state writes back the line to L2, and this is when the L2 cache gets the new data. All right. Until then, it doesn't have it. Now the question is then you ask, why did I do this then? Why should I fill the data in M state in L2 cache, even though the L2 cache is having the old data? Okay. The reason is this. If the line is evicted from L2 cache in M state, then you're in trouble. Because unless you send the correct data back to memory, there's a chance of losing the new data, actually. Okay. So whenever you evict an M state L2 cache block, you first ask the L1 data cache to send the most up-to-date copy, if any. Then it writes the line back to the next higher level, that is L3 or main memory, in our phase system. So why inclusion is important? It simplifies something called a coherence protocol, which we'll not at all discuss in this course. So there is something called a coherence protocol. Maybe we'll discuss it a little bit when we talk about input-output devices, but not much in detail. Right? So just keep in mind that there is a reason why this is done. Okay. Not that one fine morning somebody decided to do this. Okay. Any question or inclusion?
Why do we need to have the data block in L2 in hand state? Whenever it evicts the block, it asks L1 to evict the data block.
Yes.
So at that time, using the state bits of L1 cache,
Yeah, right. No, but you have to think about the low-level implementation details. So when the L2 cache evicts the block, okay, it needs to know whether it requires a data response or not from the L1 cache. If it does, it has to allocate a buffer to put the data. Okay. So the purpose is reservation, nothing else. You have to reserve some buffer for filling the data that comes back from the L1 data cache.
This is like after every store, we have to modify the state bits of L2 cache.
Right, we have to tell the L2 cache that I'm going to do a store.
Yes. Isn't it an overhead kind of thing? Like, you have to go to L2 cache.
It's actually needed, that's why, in a multiprocessor environment. Today, every processor is a multiprocessor. And a multiprocessor, you can't avoid doing that. If you are doing a store, you have to tell others that we're doing a store. Mm-hmm. Because others may have the copy of the old data.
No, you don't.
Only the first one. Yes, that's right. So just to clarify what they are actually discussing, consider a sequence of accesses. Like processor first loads the data in the valid state in the L1 data cache. All right, and also in L2 cache. Okay. Subsequently, the processor wants to write to that particular cache block. All right. So then, what has to happen? What he's saying is that at this point, I must tell the L2 cache to move to M state, okay? Because that's what it actually tells me. Okay, that is the invariant. That if you have a dirty block in L1 data cache, the corresponding block in L2 cache must be in M state. Okay, all right. So he's saying that that's a big overhead. And the answer is yes, it is an overhead, okay, which we actually cannot avoid in multiprocessors, which I won't clarify here. But intuitively, why you need to do this is that you may have a copy of data shared by two processors. If one processor modifies the value of that data, other must know the modified value. All right? So before one processor does a store to that data, you must tell the other guy that this data is no longer the correct value. All right? So there has to be a notification that has to go. Okay. Any other questions? One inclusion? Yes.
Why do you want the state to change to M?
Oh, because otherwise, if the block gets evicted from L2, the memory may not get updated with the correct data. That's why.
No, but eviction of an L2 line in M state first asks the L1 data cache.
But it's not in M state.
Oh.
Yeah. Right. But what he has suggested, I mean, again, I'll iterate that. What he's saying is that, well, in any case, an eviction from L2 cache will ask the L1 cache, right, all the time for maintaining inclusion. So then why have an M state? So it's just a matter of the low-level implementation. Because if it is an M state, L2 will know that there is a potential data response that can come from L1 data cache. Okay. So it may reserve some buffer space to fill that data. Okay, all right. So it's just a low-level implementation detail. If you want to ignore that, then yes, you're right. You don't need to switch the L2 cache to M state. You don't need that. Any other questions? Okay. There are actually many other states which I'm not really talking about, which does complicate matters but give you some extra benefits. Like the case that we're discussing may actually be handled with some extra states, but I'll not go into that detail. All right, so with that, let's try to trace the sequence of events that happen when the first instruction of a newly started program executes. All right. So you take the starting program counter. You access the instruction TLB, right? Because the program counter is a virtual address.
translate it to physical address. We access the instruction.
So you access the instruction TLBU, the virtual page number, extracted from the PC. And since it's the first instruction, you're going to have an instruction TLB miss. You won't be able to find the translation. So you invoke the ITLB mishandler. The ITLB mishandler has the responsibility of calculating the page table entry address. If the page table entries are cached in L1 data and L2 caches, this one we discussed a little bit last time that you can do this. Look them up with the page table entry address. However, in this case, you're going to miss there also within the first instruction. Then you access the page table in main memory. And the page table entry is going to be invalid in this case, which means you take a page fault, right? So you invoke the page fault handler, allocate the page frame, read page from disk, update the page table entry, load the page table entry in the instruction TLB, restart the instruction fetch, all right? So now you have the physical address, because this time, of course, the fetcher will get the translation from ITLB. So you can access the instruction cache, which is going to be a miss. Here's the first instruction, you won't have it in the cache. Send a refill request to higher levels. You will miss everywhere. So in this case, we follow this path. You miss here, then you look up L2, you're going to miss here. So go to memory now, okay, all right? And you send the request to the memory controller, which used to be called the NOT bridge long back. Now, it's not really relevant anymore because memory controllers are now inside the processor chip, okay? So what guarantees that this particular instruction page will be found in memory? How do you know? Because I said the next step is, you know, memory controller is a passive device. It gets a request, it gets an address, it sends the request to the memory, that's it. What guarantees you that this particular page is in memory currently? Yeah? How do you know that the data that the memory will return to the memory controller will be correct? Because at this point there is no check. Memory controller gets an address, forwards it to the memory, that's it. Answer is already discussed. In the last slide, okay? Exactly. So this particular action makes sure that the data will be in the world. Alright? Okay, so you read the cache block from main memory. So now the cache block comes back. And while coming back, on its way, it will fill the L2 cache. It will fill the L1 instruction cache. And return the particular instruction word to the processor. Alright? So extract the appropriate instruction from the cache line with the block offset. And then the fetcher can start. So now the processor has the instruction. Finally, it can decode, can execute, whatever it wants. Right? So this is the longest possible latency in an instruction data access. Okay. Is the sequence clear to you? Roughly what happens. Okay. So a little bit more on the TLB access. The important observation to make here is that for every cache access instruction or data, you need to access the TLB first. So that's what gives you the physical address. Okay. So it puts the TLB in the critical path of every instruction, right? If you have a slow TLB, your instruction execution is going to be slow. Simple as that. So if you remember, the point is that you take the virtual page number, look up the TLB, you get the physical page frame number, you concatenate that with the page offset, you get the physical address, and then you can look up the cache, right? So that puts your TLB in the critical path, right? Because the cache access cannot be done until the TLB access is completed. So I put a plus here, this is just calculation. Right? Right? So is this step? So this is a sequential operation, right? I look up the TLB and the cache in sequence. Okay. There is no overlap. Okay. So what I ideally want is to start indexing into the cache and read the tags while TLB lookup takes place. So I want to do this lookup and this lookup in parallel. Okay. How can I do that? So the only way to do it is to index the cache with the virtual address. Because to begin with, I only have the virtual address and nothing else. Okay. So the question is, can I use part of the virtual address to index the cache? Okay. And I can have my tag in the cache derived from the physical address. Because by the time I look up the cache and the tag comes out, I would have the physical page frame number from the TLB so that I can now do a tag comparison. So this is called virtually indexed, physically tagged cache. And that is what is used today in all commercial processors, at least for the L1 cache. Okay, right? So you extract index for the virtual address, start reading tag while looking up the TLB. Once the physical address is available, you do the tag comparison. So it overlaps the TLB reading and cache tag reading. Is it clear to everybody? So it relaxes these latencies a little bit more. Okay. Because now you can afford to make your TLB a little slower. You can afford to make your cache a little slower, but still not use anything. All right? Because now these two will go in parallel. So here's the typical relative latencies in the memory hierarchy. Don't take these as authoritative numbers. These are just examples, just to show you what the gaps are. Okay. So L1 heat latency is about a nanosecond today. L2 heat latency is about 5 nanoseconds. L3 is 10 to 15 nanoseconds. Main memory is about 70 nanoseconds DRAM access time, plus bus transfer, etc. So it gives you about 110 to 120 nanoseconds. Okay, all right. And if you have a more complicated system, things may vary more. See, here I'm talking about a variance of about 10 nanoseconds, variation of 10 nanoseconds. Okay. The gap between minimum and maximum may be even larger, depending on the architecture. So the point here is that there is a very big jump from L3 to main memory. Okay, all right. So L3 cache is, or the last level of the cache, is your last line of defense. Okay. If you miss there, you're going to take a very big performance hit. That's pretty obvious. All right. So your last level cache should be very intelligent. It should be able to identify which data blocks are important, should retain them, all right, and make room for them by throwing away the useless blocks, all right. So it has to do some form of a prediction by looking into the future in some way and say that, well, I think this block is going to be reused in future, so I'll keep it. That block doesn't look like to be reused in future, I'll throw it away and make room for some other useful one, right? So your cache controller has to be fairly smart to be able to do these things. And it's a very hot research topic because you can see actually why it is. There are good reasons for that. If your last level cache is a dump cache, your processor is not going to give you good performance. That's pretty obvious, okay, all right? Because this jump is enormous, actually. So just to give you the problem a little bit more concretely, if a load misses in all caches, it will eventually come to the head of the ROB, right? You have the ROB, right? You don't have a buffer. So this is my ROB. So this is the head. So this is where my retirement is currently running. Okay, I'm retiring instructions from here. And let's suppose there is a load here which is currently executing. Okay. This one is currently looking up the cache, all right? So this particular load instruction looks up the L1 data cache, misses in the L1 data cache. It goes and looks up the L2 cache. Remember that in the meantime, the ROB is progressing, okay? The head is actually moving gradually. It is retiring instructions, all right? So the point is that if, before I get the data for the load, if this head moves down here, I have to stop because I cannot retire the load. So now, not only I can retire the load, I cannot retire any of these instructions because the retirement has to be in order. So that's a big problem, which means I have only this much of time to get the data for the load, okay, to make sure that the processor doesn't stop. Now, if a particular load instruction misses in all the caches and has to go to memory, you can imagine the large amount of time that it has to it's going to take. So we did a calculation last time. Maybe I should remind you about the calculation. Suppose your processor runs at 3 gigahertz, right? And let's suppose that you retire 4 instructions per cycle. Okay, all right. And so what does it mean? So your cycle time is 1/3 nanosecond.
Okay, right.
So if I assume that, let's say, you know, let's be optimistic. Let's suppose that we have 100 nanosecond memory access, you know, memory time.
Okay,
all right. So within 100 nanosecond, let's assume that I'll get the data back. So that's essentially how many cycles? 300 cycles. 300 cycles, right? I retire 4 instructions every cycle. So I need an ROP of size 1200, right, to be able to hide the latency of this load, which is impossible. Today's ROP size are few hundreds, maybe 200. Okay. So this is the problem. Okay, why loads impose a problem, and this is the reason that you cannot retire anything beyond a certain point. And if you have an ROP of length 100, okay, right, it will take only 25 cycles to get to a stall point, okay, which is a very small fraction of 300 cycle latency. Okay. So, which is why today, actually, if you look at applications that access big data, a large amount of data, you'll hear numbers like 90% stall time. This is the reason. So one way of resolving it is to have a smart last level cache. Okay. Make it smart enough so that it can retain important data, so that you don't have to go to memory too often. Okay. All right. Okay, so yeah, so gradually the pipeline backs up, processor runs out of resources, and ultimately the fetcher stalls, which severely limits IOP. Okay. So that's the basic problem. So we'll talk about some of the simple solutions here that the processor industry has adopted over time to alleviate this particular problem somewhat. Right. So essentially, what you need is memory level parallelism. So till now, we have been talking about instruction level parallelism, where you find out instructions which can be executed in parallel, okay, and you let them execute in parallel. You offer resources and all. So the same question we can ask about memory operations. So can I execute multiple memory operations in parallel? Okay, right? That's called memory level parallelism. So simply speaking, you need to mutually overlap several memory operations. Okay. Why is that useful? Because then, if you have two memory operations executing concurrently, for both of them, you'll see a latency of 100 nanosecond. It's not like 200 nanosecond. So that's the advantage. You get overlap in time. So how do you achieve that? So first step is to have a non-blocking cache. Okay, what is that? You allow multiple outstanding cache misses. That's the first requirement. That is, you cannot now say that whenever my cache gets the first miss, it is going to reject all subsequent requests until this miss is resolved. Then of course you are not going to get any memory level parallelism. That's out of question. Okay, because the cache itself is acting as a blocking agent. Okay, right? So this is the first requirement, that the cache must allow multiple outstanding cache misses. Even when it has a bunch of misses outstanding, it should still be able to accept more requests, allow them to go through the cache. Maybe they will, some of them will hit, some of them will miss, right? And they should proceed. Okay. So you mutually overlap multiple cache misses, supported by all microprocessors today. for example, Alpha 21364 supported 16 outstanding cache misses. So today's numbers are roughly around this. With how many outstanding cache misses you can support. The reason why there has to be a limit is because you have to remember somewhere that what are the misses that are still outstanding. There has to be a table, right? And that limits the number that you can actually support. And this table is actually pretty much on the critical path, so that's why it has to be small. It cannot be very large. So is this solution clear to everybody? That's the first step. That you have to let the cache, so you cannot
You cannot have a blocking cache.
The second one is out of order load issue. That is, you issue loads out of program order. This one also we discussed earlier. Address is not known at the time of issue. So what you do is you first, the first phase of the load issue actually computes the address. Comes back, compares its address with the source before it. Right? And then only it can go and access the memory. So how do you know the load didn't issue before a store to the same address? So issuing stores must check for this memory order violation. So let's talk about it a little more in detail. So here's an example. I have a store here, and there are a bunch of instructions, and then I have a load. All right. So let's assume that the load issues before the store, because R20 gets ready before R6 or R7. For the store to issue, I need to make sure that both of these are available, R6 and R7. For load to issue, I need to make sure that R20 is available. Alright, so let's assume that whoever was generating R20 completed first, and so now a load can issue. Right? So load accesses the store buffer. So this is essentially the value field in the store queue that we talked about. Alright, this is used for holding already executed store values before they are committed to the cache at retirement. If it misses in the store buffer, it looks up the caches and say gets the value somewhere. Right. After several cycles, the store issues, and it turns out that these two addresses are actually same. Right. So, or they overlap. So now that means the load must have got a wrong value. Okay. So maybe you have forgotten. So let me try to remind you. So let's suppose that we have this single issue queue, and this load instruction here is this one. Let's say this is the load. And let's suppose this is the store, that store instruction. All right? So previously we said that the condition for a load to issue is that all the stores before it must have computed their addresses. All right? That's what we said. Okay, now what I'm doing is I'm going to relax that. Because that, we already said that this looks very conservative, because many of the loads will not depend on any of these stores. Okay. Why are you then delaying the issue of those loads? Okay. All right. So now I'm saying that, well, I don't care. I'll issue the load as soon as its operand gets ready, this is R20. All right. Which means some of these stores may not have executed yet. Okay. Which means some of these stores may not have computed their addresses. Okay. So what does the load do when it issues? It first computes its own address. Okay. It comes back, compares its address with all the stores before it. And here we are assuming that it doesn't match with anybody. And the reason is that this store hasn't yet executed. Okay, all right? Because R6 or R7, one of them or both of them may not be ready yet. So then the load goes happily, accesses the cache, gets the data somewhere. All right? Supplies the data to its dependents that are sitting here. They also start executing. Eventually, R6 and R7 get ready. The store issues, executes, and you find that these addresses are actually same. So load has not only consumed the wrong data, it has supplied the wrong data to many dependents after it. How do you recover from this error? That's a problem. Any suggestion? Is the problem clear to everybody? Okay. So we are now, the problem arises because we are trying to issue loads very aggressively out of order. How do I fix it? So the previous slide, there was a comment here. Issuing stores must check for this memory order violation. Can somebody expand around that line? Is the load instruction still inside the processor somewhere? Or has it retired? So retirement has to be in order, so the load hasn't yet escaped. You can still catch it and fix it. How?
Store may check if a load ahead of it, load after it,
mm-hmm.
has loaded from the same memory,
mm-hmm.
and it can fix it. Or it can issue something.
So an issuing store should check all loads after it that have already executed.
and do a comparison of addresses, right? Okay. And if there are multiple matches, what should we do?
There might be multiple loads that are executed to the same address.
Fix all of them.
Fix all of them, right?
Yeah.
So by fixing, what do you mean? Can you elaborate?
Override
the value.
Load is loading into some register.
That's okay.
So we change the value.
That's all. The instructions which are supposed to read those registers have already read and have executed. What about those instructions?
They have to be re-executed.
So you have to also find out the dependence of these loads, right? Which have executed.
So there are two modes of fixing. So the first step is, of course, that an issuing store must check all subsequent loads that have already executed. By checking, I mean compares the address. Okay, all right. Of course, an issuing store cannot compare address. First, it issues, computes its address, and then only it can do that. All right. So it checks all the loads. The simple solution is that it picks the oldest load that matches and removes all instructions after it. Okay, all right. So it re-executes everything after that. Okay.
So of course, it will do some extra amount of work. It will actually re-execute many instructions which do not depend on this offending load, right?
But it's a simpler solution. You don't have to keep track of dependencies. A slightly more complicated solution would actually maintain the dependence tree of each load. So starting from the load, you can think of it as a root. It will actually source the value to a bunch of instructions, forming a tree, all right? You keep track of the tree.
Okay.
So that's what today's Intel processors actually do. They keep track of the tree of every load, all right, in a buffer. So that actually minimizes your wasted work in this case. All right. So that's precisely what the solution is. So this is called speculative memory disambiguation. So essentially, we are doing one form of speculation here. Why did we issue the load? Because we are speculating that this load won't have any problem, won't ever conflict. Okay. So computer architects are very optimistic about whatever they do. So here again, we are being optimist, and we're saying that there won't be any problem if you issue this, okay, all right? The good news is that it is correct most of the time.
Okay.
That's why it works. Otherwise, of course, you'll drown in poor performance. So assumes that there will be no conflicting store. If the speculation is correct, you have issued the load much earlier, and you have allowed the dependents to also execute much earlier, all right? If there is a conflicting store, you have to squash the load and all the dependents and that have consumed the load value and re-execute them systematically. Right? Turns out that the speculation is correct most of the time. And often this is called a blind speculation because you're not really using any property of the load. You're oblivious about the history of this load. Because in the past, this load might have conflicted with the same store. Okay, all right? But here you are not caring about that. You're saying that I'll do a blind speculation, I'll issue this load, whatever maybe its history telling me, okay, all right? So you can improve upon that. So that's what today's processors do. They use simple memory dependence predictors, which predicts if a load is going to conflict with a pending store based on that load's past behavior, all right? So you can actually make association between the pair of loads and stores, all right? You can store the association in a table and figure out in future if this load actually is going to conflict with any of the stores that are waiting here. If it is, then you won't actually issue this load. You'll wait until all the stores have, or at least the predicted conflicting store has gone. Okay, all right. So this is what processors do today. I won't be able to discuss about the actual predictive implementations. If you want to read about that, I can give you some papers. So they look very, very much like branch predictors, but they have to be a little smarter. Because here you're talking about establishing an association of a pair, a load and a store, essentially, okay, all right? But still, the query is a binary query. So yes, no answer will come, okay, all right? Just like a branch predictor. Okay. You take a load and ask, tell me if it is safe to issue this load. Right? So the predictor will give you a yes no answer. So today, microprocessors try to hide cache misses by initiating early prefetches. That's another solution. Hardware prefetchers try to predict next several load addresses and initiate cache line prefetch if they're not already in the cache. So I hope you're noticing that there are many flavors of pattern predictors that go into a processor at various levels, actually. So
So this is again another pattern predictor that mines the pattern of addresses that are accessed by the cache and tries to predict the future. Okay, they tell me what addresses are going to come in future. Can I fetch them now? Okay. So by the time it is needed, it will be in the cache. All right. All processors today support prefetch instructions also, so you can actually specify in your program when to prefetch. When to prefetch what? So the compiler can actually insert these instructions at appropriate places. This gives much better control compared to hardware prefetcher because here you can actually see the whole program. Okay. And also you can maintain the semantic of the program. For example, you can see that it's an array access, so you know that it's going to be very predictable. You'll be accessing sequentially the array locations. The addresses are extremely predictable actually. Whereas this guy, the hardware prefetcher, is a finite state machine, sitting there monitoring addresses and just making a prediction, a blind prediction. So there's a bigger chance that it may be wrong. Okay. But of course, it has an advantage that it can see all addresses, which the compiler cannot. Okay. For example, dynamically allocated memory addresses won't be visible to the compiler. All right. Another solution that the researchers have explored is load value prediction. That is, I am loading a particular piece of data, like here. Can I predict what this load is going to return, the value, okay, right? So that also has been explored. It's a much difficult problem because you're not trying to predict a 32-bit or 64-bit value, all right? So the entropy is expected to be much higher. So it's not very easy, and accuracy is usually low, which is why the industry hasn't yet adopted this particular solution. Okay? But there is a large body of research on this, how to predict the load values. And the good thing is that the programs often load constants. A lot of constants are loaded often. Okay, and the most loaded constant is zero. So these values you can predict extremely easily, okay, without much trouble. Even after doing all these things, the memory latency remains the biggest performance bottleneck, and that's called the memory war. Okay, so it's a very hot research topic, and probably will remain a hot research topic for a long time, because there is no easy solution visible in the near future. Processors are expected to get faster. Memory is not getting faster at the same rate. So the speed gap is going to increase. So your 90% stall time may become 95% stall time in future, okay, going forward. So I'm going to stop here. So next time we'll delve deeper into caches.